We're about to go into the Canadian National Anthem. I'm Double H here with Captain Lou. We are live from Kalamazoo, Michigan for Division II playoffs, and we have O Canada right now. Of the Canadian and the American National.
I'm both in there, Double H.
I am Double H here with
Captain Lou Albamo.
We are so thrilled to be in Kalamazoo, Michigan for the Division II playoffs, day two.
Day one was madness. Day two, getting started in the consolation bracket. Carolina Roller Girls going up against Suburbia, the Suburban Brawl. This is a 10-4 game with the winners advancing to potentially play for fifth place. They'll be playing against Tri-City. later today.
That's right. Each one of these teams kind of not where they expected to be today. Seed 10 is Suburbia against Paper Valley. They lost 308 to 107, so that's a differential of about 200 points. Carolina definitely didn't have the game they thought they were going to have against number 5 seed Neo Roller Derby yesterday. That score was 222 to 178. We do have Carolina and Suburbia on the jammer line right now, though, and we're getting ready to go, Captain Lou.
Roller Derby on a Saturday morning, Double H.
Good times. And that is Carolina pushing her way through. Ginger clobbers through to become lead jammer for Carolina. I'm sorry, no, that is not Ginger Clobbers. Let's try that again.
That's Charlotte Popowski.
That is. We're going to take another look at the roster here. And we're working on a really solid pack that is a 4-3 pack right now. Actually, 3-3 pack. We do have another pass for Carolina. Is finally out of the box. That is Suburbia in the red and white, and Carolina in the black and red. It's Saturday morning, Captain Lou.
Saturday
morning.
That's right. We had a time crunch with those national anthems. We'll get this thing under control. 5 points going up on the board for Suburbia early on in this bout. Suburbia happy with their early results. Charlotte Popowski, the top scorer in the first game of this tournament for Suburbia, picking up 69 points in that game against Paper Valley. Looks like number 50, Lauren Forster, is going up against number 75. She's a freak. She's a freak. Picking up 106 points against Neo yesterday.
Quit a game, both of those teams. We do have 4-on-3 pack advantage right now for Carolina, again in the black and red. Both jammers getting delayed. That is a multiplayer penalty causing Carolina number 12, that's MC Fight, headed to the penalty box right now. We do have lead jammer for Carolina, though. That is some momentum for them right now. Carolina nothing, Suburbia 5 points. This is where that could change. And right there, Carolina's jammer takes a quick look. She gets 4 points, calls it off. Not quite sure, Captain Lou. She looks at the bench to see what's up.
Checking in, wanting to make sure she's supposed to call it off. In the blink of an eye, we lost almost all of our blockers on that jam. And
that's never a good thing.
No, second jam in. 5 points for Suburbia, 4 points for Carolina again. Suburbia in the red, Carolina in the black. Little Loca taking the star, number 66 for Suburbia.
And we are down now to a 2-1 pack. This is a micro pack, Captain Lou. We do have lots and lots of penalties racking up already. We are seeing a lot of action from the jammers right around the outside. That is Suburbia grabbing lead jammer status there. Right now, 5 points to Carolina's 4. And Little Loca's going to really work her way around. We do have 3-on-2 now. Pack advantage for Suburbia. She's pushing her 3-wall forward. She's saying, go, 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 get me some points. Looking for a little bit of an apex jump. Can't quite get it. Can't get her hips in front either. That's a gain of nothing right there, Captain Lou.
Neuralizer throws her hands up in the air, thinking that she may have picked up some points just before that fourth whistle blew. No success for either side. Score remains 5-4. Suburbia with an early lead. Lots of time left in this game. 26 minutes and 40 seconds.
That is Charlotte. Yeah, that's Charlotte Popowski on the jammer line. That's number 382 for Suburbia. And as I psychically called it before, 299 Ginger Clobbers for Carolina. She is a seasoned vet for Carolina. We are looking at a pack disadvantage, though, for Carolina as we see Ginger kind of working her way through the outside. Doesn't quite make it. Comes up against that wall, letting Suburbia through. That is Charlotte through for lead jammer. For Suburbia again in the red and white. We're looking at Suburbia 5, Carolina 4, Captain Lou.
Again, Charlotte Popowski showing that she is the lead jammer and the top jammer for Suburbia in this tournament. Skipping through that apex, Double H, 4 points going on the board for Suburbia. So and the game's going back and forth nicely.
It is the Carolina Roller Girls in the black and red, Suburbia in the red and white. Suburbia coming into this tournament, number 10. They were psyched to be here. Carolina, number 4, really expected to have a little bit better of a turnout, I think, against the number 5 seed Neo Roller Derby yesterday. But nonetheless, they are going to come out swinging.
Looks like Katie Klismick lining up for Carolina. That's number 50, Lauren Forster for Suburbia.
Lauren Forster getting forced to the inside. really working at the front of the pack. Carolina through to become lead jammer. Excellent two-all up front from Suburbia, though. Each one of these teams has a full complement of blockers on the track. See how long that lasts. A multiplayer call being levied against Carolina. That is 121 electrocution. And working our way through the front, Katie Klismic comes up with a handful of points and calls it. And that is a four-point pass for Carolina.
So again, lead jammer going back and forth between the teams. Points getting scored on alternate jams. 9-8 for Suburbia, only a one-point lead. Rydell is the official skate of the WFDDA. Unmatched quality, unmatched performance. Online at rydellskates.com.
That is number 1958, Reading Rambo on the line for Suburbia. And she is coming up against Katie Compton, 187 for Carolina Roller Girls. And that's the jam. Katie Rowe getting forced down around turn one on the inside, taken out. There is a back block call levied against her. This is now a power jam for Suburbia, Lou.
Yeah, first power jam of the game. Let's see how Suburbia does on it. Both of these teams giving up a lot of power jams in their first game. Got to capitalize when that advantage is there.
And another advantage for them, lead jammer status for Suburbia. Really working against that nice juke for her. That's 5 points right now for Reading Rambo.
MC Fight going to the box as well. Their captain for Carolina. That's her second trip.
We do have 3-on-2 pack advantage for Suburbia now. That's 5 more points. They got the no pack call. They're forced to reformulate. That is number 7, Aurora Thunder at the front. Really trying to hold her back, but they're forced to let her go. Another 5 points for Reading Rambo.
Yeah, Suburbia doing a good job putting points up on board. 15 so far on this power jam. She's coming around for another scoring pass, Double H.
Electrocution back on the track. But getting sent back off, I believe that was a back block call for number 121 electrocution. Meanwhile, Suburbia's pack, that's little Loca 66, signaling to her jammer to call it, which she does.
Yeah, that's going to ice Katie in the penalty box, allowing Suburbia to have a power start. They're putting Charlotte Papowski out there. Lets them extend the effect of the power jam, give them perhaps an opportunity to pick up a second lead jammer, put points up on the board. Penalty troubles early on in this game for Carolina.
And we're seeing a complete set of blockers on the track right now for Suburbia. That's 4-on-2 for Carolina. And this is a power jam right around the outside lead jammer status. Really quick work of that two wall there, Lou.
Malcolm Sex indicating to Katie Compton as she comes out of the penalty box to skate around so that she can pick up speed and approach the packs. Power jam is over.
Popowski gets forced to the inside. She's not quite sure. She takes a look really quickly to see if she's lead because it looked almost like she was going to call it off. She did not know where Carolina's jammer was, but she found her. That was fairly easy to see. That was Katie Compton. Juking to the inside. Almost a little quick apex jump for Charlotte, and she calls it. That's a 5-point pass for Suburbia.
And we had a Suburbia skater lose a truck on that jam. She was down to 6 wheels. I'm trying to spot who it was. It was the pivot for that jam. But I imagine she's going to need some skate work done.
That
by
is
the skate repair
you
crew.
You do not want to skate down a wheel or two. That's
no.
That's not going to work out for you. Number 75, She's a Freak, skating for Carolina. And that is number 50, Lauren Forcer for Suburbia. Lauren looking for a hole on the inside, can't quite find it, pushed to the outside. Coming up behind the pivot for Carolina, and she does get lead jammer status really quickly there, Lou.
Yeah, Suburbia really rolling early on in this game. They put up 25 points on the board over the two jams that they had the advantage.
And that is going to be a low block call against the Carolina skater for that takedown, that blocker takedown. That's 4 more points for Suburbia.
And yeah.
It looks like that's number 365, Earn a Beaten, for Carolina going to the box.
Oh, dear. So penalty troubles continue. Lauren Forcer with a nice quick hit it and quit it. Looks like Carolina had picked up 40 penalty minutes in their first game, so they're back into penalty trouble again in this one, Double H.
I was looking to see if Erna was in fact going to sit in the penalty box, and she did. We do have Smashing Pumpkin on the line against Charlotte. So each one of these jammers looking to gain some points back. Carolina down. That's Suburbia 38 points to Carolina's 8 points. Suburbia gets lead jammer status here. That's a 30-point deficit. Charlotte races out in front to become lead jammer for Suburbia. Meanwhile, Smashing Pumpkin hot on her heels. We'll see how long it takes for Charlotte to call it. She's looking to her bench to see if she should call it or not. Each one of these teams looking for at least a point. Charlotte's not quite sure she can get that point because there's a two-all in front. She's looking to find, yes, she sneaks through the inside to steal 4 points for Suburbia, leaving Carolina with none, and that is a team timeout for Carolina. I think that's a really good time for them to take a timeout.
That's an awesome time to take a timeout. This game could be getting away from them. They need to reset. They need to get everything under control. You notice on the scoreboard overlay, you can see the blinking trapezoid underneath Carolina's name, which now indicates that that timeout will be taken. When the timeout is complete, that will fill in. You'll be able to see that there are two dark remaining on Carolina's side, showing that they have two more timeouts, whereas Suburbia currently has three. Little white, pink, clear one, that is for the official reviews. It's the update of the scoreboard display, and I really like it, Double H.
I wish my trapezoids were as attractive.
Oh, they are beautiful trapezoids.
I went there. Let's talk about yesterday. We had a variety of games that ended up a lot differently than I think a lot of people expected, and very close games, in fact, as well.
Yes.
Starting off with the first game, Tri-City Roller Girls taking on Burning River. That was a 20... under 20 points, 190 Tri-City to Burning River, 174. So a lot of these games are really, really close. Paper Valley was a game against Suburbia that had a very large differential here with 308 to 107. So I know Suburbia is really looking to make up for lost time here in this bout against Carolina.
Absolutely. Jam back underway. Lauren Forster jamming for Suburbia, quickly getting lead jammer, Double H.
Yeah, and she is jamming against number 299, Ginger Clobbers for Carolina, who's still stuck in the pack behind a beautiful three wall of Suburbia blockers. And there is a little bit of action at the front where both of them sandwiching her together. Meanwhile, at the back, we are trying to see a full pass from Suburbia. She gets through the inside and calls it for 4 points. Meanwhile, Carolina, again, not able to pick up much there.
Yeah, Carolina pivot Katie Compton doing a good job of holding back the jammer from Suburbia, keeping her in the pack, but she still managed to get past her to get those points. Suburbia at 46, Carolina at 8. Adam Wheels, a proud partner and an official wheel of the WFTDA, online at adamwheels.com.
So again, that's number 26, Katie Klismick, jamming for Carolina, who is in the black and red, and that is Charlotte Pupowski for Suburbia in the red and white. Katie getting forced down, really forced to let the pack go there. Charlotte actually forced the inside out of bounds. Hopping back on the track does not draw a cut. It was a nice safe play for her, but Carolina, a shift of momentum, lead jammer status right there out of the gate. Meanwhile, we do still have getting forced out of bounds. Charlotte Pupowski gets a no pass, no penalty call. She is now in front of Katie, who's taking a look. She gets 4 points and calls it as her opposing jammer gets in front of her.
That ends a six jam scoring drought for Carolina, putting points up on the board, 46 to 12 now. Carolina finally getting back in the right direction. Looks like that timeout may have helped them out. Suburbia scoring on the first jam after it, but Carolina getting points on the board. It's a long game. Nail Diamond taking the star for Suburbia, and that's number 75. She's a freak, the top scorer again for the first game of this tournament for Carolina.
We do have a pack advantage, though, here for Carolina. Let's see if it buys them anything. Yes, opening a big hole on the outside for their jammer. She comes up against two, but really forced to sort of out of bounds, hop back in play on the right spot of the track, getting forced almost out of bounds at turn two. Beautiful work there from Carolina's jammer, staying in bounds. She's a freak. Indeed she is, Captain Lou.
Picking up lead jammer and still stuck in the pack is a jammer for Suburbia, and quickly through for 5 points, Double H. That's She's a Freak.
And that is exactly what they were looking for. We now have pack advantage for Carolina. 3-on-2 there for Carolina to Suburbia, and now it's 3-on-1. Suburbia right now a revolving door of penalties as Carolina's jammer, She's a Freak, is able to make it through one more pass. Suburbia's jammer really getting stuck at the back there. Not a lot of luck for her. That is number 333, Nail Diamond, getting taken down again. Her two blockers cannot give her much assistance. She's a freak, finds an easy hole on the inside and outside. And now we're within striking distance. Suburbia 46 to Carolina 32. This is a very close game now. The kind of momentum shift Carolina was hoping for, as another pass gives five more points to She's a Freak.
And Carolina is doing this not on a power jam. Both jammers are on the track, and this is the kind of jam that really can amp up your team. You've managed to neutralize the other jammer. You put lots of points up on the board. Carolina at 41 now. It's a five-point game. They've quickly closed the gap, and they've done it with keeping players on the track.
She's a Freak really did some damage there for Carolina. Suburbia in the red and white at 46 points. Carolina at the black and red with 41 points. 15 minutes or so left to go in this period. Already the momentum is shifting. That is Charlotte Bupowski on the jammer line there for Suburbia. Doing a little dance with Smashing Pumpkin from Carolina. And we do have two on two. So really pack advantage, no one. But the advantage now goes to Carolina, who has lead jammer status.
Yeah, once again, and Daisy Rage at the back of the pack doing a great job of keeping Charlotte in the pack, allowing her jammer to get out, and she's got a chance to score now, Double H.
Now, again, penalty is a huge issue for Suburbia in this last jam in particular. We do have an issue, though, for Carolina. This is now a power jam. That is a track-cutting penalty for Smashing Pumpkin. She's going to the box. This is now a power jam. The momentum shifting in the opposite direction. This is Charlotte Bupowski really working on a three-on-three pack. So we're going to see some slowdown at the back of the pack. We're going to get not even close to that no pack call. And the back is the pack. So there's still a pack extending very nicely at the front as Carolina. She does get through for 5 points at Charlotte Bupowski. And no, she is getting the track cut call. And now we're swinging in the opposite direction, Captain Lou.
That's right. Jammer chair swap out. Charlotte stumbling just at the end of that last hit, falling to the ground, touching out of bounds. That counts as cutting the track. When she got back up, she got sent to the notorious RED penalty box. So now 5 points going on the board for Smashing Pumpkin. This jam's going to run the full 2 minutes. And Smashing Pumpkin fighting her way through the front, trying to get past Little Loca, gets past Anticlimax, and another 5 points go up on the board for Carolina. Those 5 points should bring this game into a deadlocked tie, Double H.
We are looking at 51-51. Suburbia again in the red and white, and Carolina in the black and red. And that is a nasty jammer takeout right around turn one on the inside.
Penalty was expired for Charlotte. She came out of the penalty box as well, also picking up 5 points for Suburbia. So Suburbia picking up the remainder of those points for their team after their jammer got out of the penalty box. 56-51, Suburbia retaining a 5-point lead. But Carolina has closed the gap, and it's almost like we're starting the game all over again. It's nice to see these momentum shifts. We've seen them all weekend long, Double H.
And now we're seeing an official timeout. I think there is going to be some conversation on both sides. But let's take a minute to talk about the rosters on both of these teams.
Why don't we?
Carolina, number 12, MC Fight. Number 121, Electrocution. Number 185, Slig and Grits. Number 187, Katie Compton. Number 1979, Neuralizer. Number 20, that's Beth Rowe. That's one of my favorite names.
Yes.
Number 22, True Destruction, who's the alternate. Number 26, Katie Klismic. 299, Ginger Clobbers. 365, Erna Beaton. 42, Ava Gore. 52, Fritzofrenic. 66, Daisy Rage. 7, Aurora Thunders. 73, Zella Lugosi, also an alternate. And 75, She's a Freak.
We'll get to Suburbia a little while later. Lauren Forrester taking the star for Suburbia, but quickly through for lead jammer, Double H. That's
Katie Compton. 187 for Carolina is now starting to warm up. It's as though Carolina came. They, you know, came out, experienced a few jams, and now they're warmed up. And that is a nice hop, skip, and a jump for 5 points for Carolina. Great work. However, we do have Lauren Forrester hot on her tail. We are going to see Katie call it off here. Lou, I think that was a smart move defensively.
Yes, indeed. making sure that Katie, or making sure that Lauren couldn't pick up any points. 60 to 56, Carolina getting those points up on the board. Suburbia remaining 4 points in the lead. Yesterday when Carolina played against Neo, they had a similar problem early on in the game. Neo came out to a big lead, and there we go, we get the score change now. We are deadlocked at 60. And then Carolina came back and really made a game of it after that. But Neo had quite a big lead at one point. Suburbia doing that in this game, but Carolina's right back in there, Double H.
And we have 4-on-3 pack advantage, Carolina, here. This is an opportunity for their jammer up at a 2-wall. Now a 1-wall, making it through to become lead jammer status. This is what Carolina needs. She's a freak, really pushing the envelope here to become lead jammer for Carolina. Suburbia having a hard time getting their jammer through. She gets forced to the inside. That is 325, Rogue Pirogue, who's having a tough time back at the back of the palm. The pile, I should say. Meanwhile, 5 more points for Carolina. This is the momentum shift I think they were hoping for. Again, that rear wall, that tight 4-wall being put up by Suburbia in the red and white. Not quite enough to hold her back. There is a bit of a break there as Carolina has another blocker going to the penalty box. Both of these teams having a tough time keeping their walls together, Lou.
Yeah, the jammers are very wily out there, and I believe we've got a fair amount of offensive blocking going on as well, so we're getting blocker on blocker, knocking the walls apart. 4 points going on the board for Carolina. They're at 69, Suburbia at 60. Fast Girl Skates, it's about you. Fast Girl Skates, serving skaters of all shapes and sizes since 2007. Find them online at www.fastgirlskates.com.
That's 187, Katie Compton on the jammer line for Carolina. And that is Charlotte Bupowski, number 382 for Suburbia. We are at 60 points for Suburbia to Carolina 69. Suburbia in the red and white, and Carolina in the black, white, and red. That is Katie Compton getting forced to the inside line. Leaps to the outside, coming around. She is forced outside at turn two. She's forced to go all the way back, and she does so without drawing the cut, which is smart. Meanwhile, Charlotte working on a 2-wall at the front from Carolina. That's electrocution up there, getting the multiplayer call. Charlotte now behind a 1-wall. She is through to become lead jammer. Beautiful offensive work against electrocution, drawing that penalty at the front. Now we have a 2-wall of Carolina defense unable to hold Charlotte at bay. That's 5 more points, Captain Lou.
And this is a power jam for Charlotte Popowski. The Katie Compton went to the penalty box. I did not see the penalty, unfortunately. Big jump through the apex. Charlotte not making it all the way, but not committing a penalty. So no harm, no foul on that one, really.
And that is number 52, Fritza Frenick from Carolina, coming back to help her teammates out, try to form a 3-wall at the front to Suburbia's 4-wall. So this is also a pack advantage for Suburbia. And we're seeing them open up and let their jammer through this 3-wall at the front with Carolina really trying to hold Charlotte. They cannot, though. They do not want to draw that pack destruction call, Lou.
But Charlotte Popowski had picked up 44 points in a one jam against North Star at Brouhaha this year. So I'm pretty sure that Suburbia is happy to have her out there on this power jam, Double H.
And that is a multiplayer call against Carolina. Again, now shortening the size of that pack. That is 1979 Smashing Pumpkin going to the box for that call. We do have Katie Compton back on the track, though, Lou.
Yeah, and she has an opportunity to stem the bleeding, but I think Charlotte's going to be able to run this out. No, she calls it off with about 5 seconds left in jam, but putting 5 more points on the board. Suburbia back in the lead. They're at 80. Carolina at 69. 20 points on that power jam, Double H.
And we're seeing so many close games this weekend. That's what's exciting about Division II play. I think the gameplay is such an exciting caliber. I think we're seeing really smart skating out here this weekend and last weekend in Des Moines.
Absolutely.
And we're learning about teams that we haven't seen a whole lot of. I think one of the exciting teams of the weekend, certainly Paper Valley, their performance yesterday against Suburbia really showed some stuff, Captain Lou. Also showing some stuff right now is Katie Klismic, getting stuck at the back of the pack, but showing even more stuff right now is number 50, Lauren Forcer for Suburbia, who is lead jammer.
Yeah, Katie also getting out of the pack, momentum shifting back in Suburban Brawl's favor as we're down under 8 minutes remaining in this half, Double H.
All right, we do have almost a full complement of blockers. That's a no-point game, though, for Carolina. 2 points for Suburbia. And each one of these teams has plenty of time to do some damage here, Lou. We got just over 7.5 minutes in the first period. Suburbia 82, they are in the red and white, and that's Carolina 69 in the black and red.
Printco, for all your printing needs, hit up printcographics.com. So yeah, Suburbia shifting momentum. We'll see what happens in this one. They're putting She's a Freak out there for Carolina again. She's the one who's been putting up a lot of points for the ladies from Carolina.
And that's 66 Daisy Rage for Suburbia. That is Carolina, though. She's a Freak through to become lead jammer. Daisy Rage looking for a hole on the inside. Gets taken out by Electrocution. Beautiful hit there from Electrocution. She gets down on one knee and back up, so she's through. But She's a Freak has some time to put some points on the board here for Carolina. Let's see what she does, Lou.
Getting forced to the outside. Little Loka, the jammer for Suburbia, coming around on her scoring pass. She was actually eliminated, fouled out in the first game. And as I say that, She's a Freak picks up a penalty.
Suburbia, beautiful work drawing the cut there against Carolina's jammer. Now a four wall of Carolina blockers holding Daisy Rage. Very slowly, Electrocution in the front there. Not picking up any penalties, though. Good work from Carolina's defense, not cutting any, getting any penalties. Meanwhile, they do draw a forearm call against Suburbia's blocker. This is not good news for Daisy Rage. She's going to the penalty box. This is better news for Carolina, though.
It is indeed. Musical chairs for the jammers. She's a Freak comes out. Little Loka goes in. Reading Rambo just went to the penalty box as well. She has 5 majors in the first half, Double H.
We are seeing a three wall against Carolina's four wall. They're able to break it up. Good defensive work here from Carolina. Suburbia looking to hold Carolina's jammer. Can't quite get her to stay. That's a 5-point pass right now for Carolina. She's a Freak, putting 5 more points on the board with Daisy Rage coming out of the box now. So the power jam is over. We do have 4-on-3 pack advantage, Carolina. That is She's a Freak getting forced to the outside. Finding a way back in without the cut, though. Sails through the pack without anybody even looking, Lou. 5 more points for Carolina.
Little Loka going down hard. Time expiring on the jam. She's holding her head. We're going to get the EMTs in there to check things out. She puts her hand up saying that she's okay.
She is saying that she's fine, so that is good news.
It looks like she did pick up 4 points during that.
And she is getting up slowly, but she's getting up. She's holding her ear. It looks like Daisy Rage went down a little bit hard on her head. She's getting up, though. That's something we love to see, skaters getting up after an injury. Thankfully. And that, oh, I'm sorry, that was Little Loka, not Daisy Rage. My mistake, sorry. The other 66.
The other 66. So many 66s in this game. So it looks like she'll be okay. She'll have to sit out for 3 jams. 5 minutes remaining. 5 minutes and 9 seconds remaining in the first half.
So the excellent thing about this, too, for those of you who are watching WFTDA.TV, is that the Carolina logo on the scoreboard in the venue is red, and the Suburbia logo is black. So I'm going to apologize in advance for the red and black mistakes today.
Indeed.
And that is Charlotte Pupowski for Suburbia, but we do have lead jammer status for Carolina.
That's Ava Gore for Carolina. Carolina down by 7 points. An opportunity to close the gap here.
And we do have a back block call being called against Ava. She's going to the penalty box for Carolina. They are down a jammer. This is now a power jam. However, we do have both jammers in the box at the same time. Now both coming back. We do have a full complement of blockers, though, for Carolina. So technically the pack advantage is for them. Let's see if that works out on the track.
Yes, Charlotte Pupowski stumbled just as she was about to sit in her seat. It meant that Ava Gore sat but 1 second before her. Charlotte sat down. They both served 1 second in the penalty box, and we got both jammers back on the track. This jam will run the full 2 minutes, Double H.
Ava's able to make 5 points on that pass for Carolina, so now we are looking at Suburbia 86, Carolina 84. Again, Carolina in the black and red. Suburbia in the red and white. Suburbia's jammer, Charlotte Pupowski, through. That is a four-point pass, though, for Ava Gore for Carolina.
And that 4 points will put Carolina back in the lead, 88-86. Carolina, with time ticking down in the half, regaining control of the bout.
That is a no-pack call, allowing Carolina's Jammer to get through for 5 more points. Ava Gore really put the nail in the coffin here on this particular jam. Meanwhile, Charlotte threw for 4 points of her own. She's not able to lap Carolina's Jammer, though. So this is a pack advantage right now for Carolina.
Yeah, some great blocking work on the part of the Carolina blockers, opening up the pack for their Jammer, then closing it right back down for Charlotte and causing another track cut right at the end of that jam on Charlotte. That means Suburbia will have their Jammer in the box, and it's going to be a power jam for Carolina. 97-92, a 5-point lead for Carolina, under 3 minutes remaining in the half.
Carolina taking advantage of this by putting She's a Freak on that jammer line. She's the most prolific jammer in this bout to date right now. And we are seeing a pretty fair amount of penalties on both sides. We are looking at a good number of 2 penalty each for Carolina skaters. A lot of clean Suburbia skaters, though. Speaking of clean, that was a clean break through the pack for She's a Freak to become lead jammer for Carolina.
She's a Freak approaching the back of that Suburbia wall. Anti-climax ends up out of bounds, and 5 points are going to go on the board as She's a Freak completes the lap, Double H.
4 Carolina blockers on the track to 3 Suburbia skaters. Those blockers really working at the front wall, and they're forced to extend so they can allow her to go, and they do. They really extended the front of that pack as far as they could, and they were forced to let her go. But it's 5 points for Carolina now over the century mark, Captain Lou.
You got to think that Roxy Rocket's sitting at home watching this game, cheering on her sister. She's got to be pretty happy with the performance that She's a Freak's putting on in this bout. Another 5 points, Double H.
I imagine Roxy and Holly Wanacrackia both sitting there enjoying this game, both with their new families in mind. Congratulations to both of those skaters for the awesomeness of a new family. That's another 5 points for Carolina. We are now looking at 112 Carolina, 92 Suburbia. Out of the box, though, is Charlotte, and she draws the clockwise blocking call against a Carolina blocker at the front. That is number 365, Erna Beaton, going back to the box. No points on that pass for Suburbia. 4 points on that pass for Carolina, Lou.
Carolina to 121, Suburbia at 92. Derby for all. Experienced derby skaters getting you the right gear to take you to the next level. Find out more at www.derbyforall.com. That's the number 4, derbyforall.com. So yeah, Carolina has all the momentum in their favor. The game has gone back and forth, but this is where Carolina wants it. The momentum going their way, going into the half, under 30 seconds remaining in the period.
With a full complement of blockers, Suburbia's got the advantage here in the pack. Lauren Forcer, though, having a tough time getting forced out of bounds. That is Katie Klismick getting forced out of bounds at turn one as well. Lauren back on the track first. She's through to become lead jammer for Suburbia. So this could potentially be an opportunity for Suburbia to really put more points on the board. However, they do have 2 blockers now headed to the penalty box. So we are looking at, and one of them must be back on in the queue. We do have 3-on-2, I'm sorry. We are looking at a no lead jammer call there for Katie Klismick. Lead jammer right now is Lauren. She looks behind and calls it. That's a 4-point gain, though, for Suburbia.
Suburbia bench coach Malcolm Sachs considered to let her keep on running with that, but then called it off, picked up those 4. Suburbia going to 96. Carolina at 121. Fifth blocker skates Scotland's first and only bricks and mortars and online roller derby star. It's Gallus. Gallus, of course, has a Scottish meaning of wild, a rascal, deserving to be hanged. Find them in Scotland or online at fifthblockerskates.co.uk. Fifth spelt 5th.
So Reading Rambo actually leading the penalties so far in this game for Suburbia. She has 5. We have a few Carolina skaters who have 2 each, and then scattered penalties throughout, but really no one skater really picking up egregious penalties right now, except for Reading Rambo, of course, for Suburbia, and that's what they're going to want to avoid.
Exactly. You don't want to foul out in the game. You want to be in there to support your team all the way through. spread those penalties out. That's good. I mean, that's good bench management as well. I mean, you're getting the right players on the track. You're not running or blockers who are picking up those penalties too many times, so that you lose. I mean, they can be effective, but they're not effective if they're not in the game anymore.
Well, I think one thing that could be a lot more effective is a lot of the wall strategies. We are seeing a few multiplayer calls. We're seeing a lot of clockwise calls and stop blocking calls. So certainly that's a sign that your defense isn't necessarily as effective as you would like it to be. So that's something that both of these teams are probably going to want to work on in the second half. It's not very many points to separate them. Carolina 121, Suburbia 96. And we're going to do our best to remind you of which color is which, because both of these teams have skated under the same colors before. And, well, we don't want to mess it up for Division II playoffs live
Absolutely
from Kalamazoo,
not.
Michigan, because it is an amazing weekend of Derby. We're going to take a quick break to thank some of our sponsors, and we'll be right back with you for the second half of Carolina taking on Suburbia.
Stop. I keep running into everything except the kitchen sink.
Man, tell me about it. These toe stops suck. I tried all of them. They feel like plastic and they keep popping off the stems.
I cannot stop. I wish somebody would help us. Help us.
Do you hear that?
I think we're needed.
Captain Antic, can you help me?
Antic skate boots.
Reckless wheels.
I wish somebody would help us. Help us.
It's okay, guys. I've got this one.
Wow! It's the gumballer!
Try these. Gumball toe stops. All natural rubber, no dyes, traction for any surface, and these will never pop off.
Jeez, thanks, mister!
This commercial is brought to you by Green Monster Roller Sports, Gumball Toe Stops, and Derby Skins.
A few years back, we noticed that a lot of girls playing roller derby were not wearing certified helmets. They were wearing non-certified soft foam helmets, and we were concerned. You can't control how you fall in roller derby. It's a contact sport. You're going to get hit, and you're going to go down, and this happens all the time. We've been trying to get the word out to everyone that plays roller derby to wear a helmet that is certified for multiple and single impacts. The Angel City Derby girls wear certified helmets.
ACDT Club, best one helmet!
It's Double H and
back.
Captain Lou, and we are working through the morning.
We are indeed.
It's a Saturday morning in beautiful Kalamazoo, Michigan. I've had donuts this morning already.
Nothing wrong with donuts in the morning?
Yes. Let's go through their rosters again. I think we already went through the Carolina rosters, but you know what? You can do Suburbia.
I'll quickly go through the Suburban Brawl from Yonkers, New York. 1057 is Vixen von Bruisen, 1958 Reading Rambo, 1979 Smashing Pumpkin, number 30 is AWOL, 325 is Rogue Pirogue, number 333, that's Neil Diamond, 382 Charlotte Papowski, 39 is Anticlimax, 44 is Piranha, 44 is Fifi Fleshwound. Number 50 is Lauren Forcer. 555 is Ay Ay Ay. And 66 is Little Oka with number 88, Helder Rays.
And we do have a very close game here. We're working on the scoreboard, fixing the scoreboard, so you can't actually tell what that is right now, but it'll be in just a minute. The Suburbia skaters are in red and white. Carolina skaters are in black and red. And each one of these teams has had kind of an interesting mixed weekend. Paper Valley versus Suburbia was the 12 o'clock game yesterday. That was game two. Paper Valley took that 308-107 and then moved on to face Sac City later in the day. And we did have an interesting bout also. Carolina really had an interesting morning there yesterday, actually afternoon at 2 o'clock game number 3 against Neo Roller Derby. They lost by less than 40 points. That was 222 for Neo to 178 Carolina. That was a really great game, though.
Yeah, Carolina came right back into that game, grabbed the lead. Neo came back. And honestly, most of those points of that differential happened in like the last 5 minutes of the game. Neo put a bunch of points up, some unfortunate penalties for Carolina, ended up sending jammers to the box. And as a result, Neo moved on to play Santa Cruz today at 2 o'clock.
And the winner here will face Tri-City later today at 4 o'clock and play for fifth place. So I know
for
that
an opportunity.
Yes, an opportunity at fifth place, I should say. The stakes are high. Each one of these teams would love to end up there. Seed number 10, of course, is Suburbia coming into this, and seed number 4 is Carolina. So if Carolina does make it to fifth place, they would, of course, drop a seed. Suburbia would climb 5 seeds.
Fair amount, yes. So we're still waiting for the technology to get everything back under control. Little stats update from the half. I went and manually did some information as opposed to...
You're one of the announcers I know who does math. This is impressive.
I can quickly add. That's one of the things I can do. She's a freak.
You're hired.
Yes, exactly. That's how it is. She's a freak, picked up 96 points in the first half of Carolina's 121. So
that's as many points as Suburbia has right now.
That is as many points as Suburbia has right now. So she's a freak, a somewhat dynamic jammer in this game, and in her previous game, putting lots of points up on the board. Lead jammer for Suburbia was Charlotte Popowski with 58 points. 24 majors going to Carolina, 19 for Suburbia. Penalty trouble, we have number 325, Rogue Pierogue on 5. Reading Rambo was back down to 4 when I last saw.
Okay.
And we've got roller derby happening, Double H.
Good deal. We've got She's a Freak for Carolina. That's number 75 against AWOL. That's number 30 for Suburbia. We do have AWOL stuck behind A2WOL. Now 1WOL and now NoWOL lead jammer status for Suburbia. That is number 66 for Carolina. That's Daisy Rage going to the penalty box. And now a power jam for Suburbia here, Lou.
Well, that's a nice way to start off your half. AWOL with the star for Suburbia getting through. She's already lead jammer, and now she's put 5 points up on the board for Suburbia. They crest the triple digit mark and are past the century.
We have 3-on-3 for both of these teams in the pack now. That's a no-pack call, and they are forced to recombobulate. That is 5 points for Suburbia. They are within striking distance. Suburbia now 106, Carolina 121. 3-on-3 pack, power jam. AWOL comes up to a stopped wall, but forces her way through the front of Carolina defenders. That is a 5-point pass for AWOL.
Pivot and captain, MC Fight doing absolutely everything she could to try to stop AWOL falling to the ground. AWOL getting past her, picking up those 5. She's back around looking to score more, Double H.
Beautiful work up there. That's Erna Beaton at the front. They're forced to let her go. And that is, I believe, an out-of-play call for the front Carolina defender. 5 more points for AWOL. Suburbia did with that exactly what they wanted to do. They're now within a handful of points. 116 Suburbia in the red and white to Carolina. 121 in the black and red. And we do have Carolina's jammer standing in the box, but we're going to start this out as a power jam with number 50, Lauren Forcer, on that line.
Yeah, nice work getting his jammer to call it off. Malcolm Sex very pleased on the bench the way the second half has started for Suburbia. Lauren Forcer taking the star.
And her blockers pulling back. They are still within a pack, though. She gets forced to the ground but becomes lead jammer. Beautiful work, not getting any calls at the front there from Carolina, too. Carolina defenders really rough and ready. We do have now, She's a Freak through, but she is not lead jammer. This is a very fast pack now. Both of these defenses do not want jammers, opposing jammers scoring points. We do have several down on the floor, though. And making it through the middle of the pack, we do have a handful of points for both of those. That's 2 points for Lauren, and that is 1 point for She's a Freak. So each one of these teams was able to come away with something there.
Yeah, Lauren managing to get past Aurora Thunder. Aurora Thunder getting picked off at the back of the pack, also picking up the not on the track point. 2 points for Suburbia. 3-point game early on in the second half. 27 minutes remaining. You got to like these really close games, Double H. They're so exciting to watch, and the back and forth action. Awesome.
I love it. That's Ginger Clobbers, 299 on the line for Carolina. That is 19-58. Reading Rambo, who gets forced to the outside, but she is lead jammer, gets taken down on the side, and she is still lead jammer, gets back up in it. We're also looking at a 1-wall holding Ginger Clobbers back. That is now a nothing wall. Eva Gore headed to the penalty box as well. We've got a 4-on-1 pack advantage. That was a beautiful call off there from Suburbia. 4 points on that pass.
Yeah, that's one of those situations when one will get you 4, 3 in the notorious RED penalty box. all picked up by passing the hips of that one blocker on the track. CrewSkateShop.com, offering quality tested derby gear and guidance since 2007. CrewSkateShop.com.
And that is Charlotte Bupowski on the jammer line for Suburbia against number 26, Katie Klismick for Carolina, getting forced to the back. Beautiful work there from Charlotte to make it through to become lead jammer. She's got an advantage here with her pack. That's a 4-on-2 pack advantage for Suburbia, and it really worked out for them because they were able to get their jammer through to become lead jammer. Rear wall here, Caddy Compton at the back, 187, really forcing her down and inside. No call on that beautiful work, but we do have a draw from a low block against Suburbia. Beautiful work here defensively from Carolina, getting Charlotte Popowski that low block call sent to the penalty box.
Yeah, I mean, with only two blockers on the track, MC Fight and Caddy Compton doing a great job of picking up that jammer penalty and allowing their jammer to be the only one who can score points, Double H.
And that three wall of Suburban defenders at the front, now a four wall. We only have three on the track for Carolina. That was a 5-point pass there for Carolina. Let's see how this four wall, great work defensively, busting up that four wall for their Carolina jammer. Another 5 points there for Katie Klismick. Great work here offensively from that three wall on Carolina. That is number 88. Helda Reyes headed to the penalty box for Suburbia. And we do still have 3-on-3 as this power jam continues.
Absolutely. Charlotte Popowski standing in the penalty box right now, under 10 seconds remaining. Four more points going on the board for the jammer from Carolina. They are extending their lead.
Five
more points. The jammer referee,
I was curious about that as well.
Didn't know where the thumb disappeared, but.
And that was a nice little apex hop there. Another 5 points there for Carolina. Charlotte out of the box now, getting forced to the inside. And that is the end of the jam. And now we have another momentum shift here, Captain Lou. Yeah. We're looking at Carolina 152, Suburbia 125, with just under 24 minutes here in the second period.
It's the same way that the game started, but this time Carolina has managed to maintain the lead. Suburbia starting off the half well, but Carolina picking up that power jam opportunity and taking full advantage of it. 152-125, 23 minutes and 30 seconds remaining in the game.
Lauren Forcer looking for a way on the outside, comes up against two defenders, and that is an official timeout.
That's usually a bad sign.
There were a couple of whistles in there that sounded a bit uncertain as the jam started, so we'll take a look and see if there was a delay of game penalty that happened.
The head ref, null pointer ref from Montreal Roller Derby, going over to check the penalty box to see if there was someone serving who wasn't supposed to be serving.
We never want that to happen.
No. No one wants to serve a minute if they don't have to serve
we
a minute.
We don't.
Printco lead the pack with new UV ink printing at printcographics.com. That's printcographics.com. We're going to get an update from our announcer ref.
Getting ready to reset here.
The answer was, we don't know. It was just a little clerical update.
It does not appear as though there were any penalties levied, so that is a good thing. Also a good thing for Suburbia right now. Lauren Forcer through to become lead jammer. We've got 3-on-2 pack advantage here for Suburbia. She's a Freak is through. Let's see how many points Lauren can grab here. There are just two Carolina defenders. She passes one in the back and comes up against the back of Electrocution. Snakes through, calls it, and she does get a gain of 4 points there, Lou.
Yeah, really nice lean against Electrocution, getting her hips past, cranking her upper body through and getting all the points. 129-152. And, we just had a scoring adjustment. I believe that's what the last official timeout was about. So Carolina dropping to 146. Suburbia 147 now. Suburbia 129. The NSO is making sure that the math is correct, doing the math multiple times during these games. They don't want the scores to be incorrect at the end.
And we have number 299, Ginger Clobbers, on the jammer line, and that is Reading Rambo, who's getting forced outside and all the way to the back of the pack. Meanwhile, we do have Ginger through for lead jammer. She is working on her scoring pass, and it looks as though Reading Rambo headed to the penalty box again for a cutting penalty. We are looking at, we believe, possibly five or six penalties for her right now in this game.
Yeah, I saw five marks on the board at the half. That's her fifth trip now, at least. So she's going to have to be careful. And wearing the star, everybody's going to the box. If you're wearing a star, you're going to go grab a seat in that notorious RED penalty box.
That's Ginger Clobbers going to the penalty box now. And we're looking at a pack advantage for neither one of these teams right now. We're completely even here, 4-on-4. Reading Rambo coming up against a four wall of Carolina defenders. Really working on it. They are allowing her to go with that pack call, that no pack call, and not getting any pack destruction calls. So that is a good thing for both of these teams. Neither one of these teams wanting to lose blockers right now. Beautiful triangle there of defense up at the front from Carolina's defense, keeping Reading Rambo, pushing her to the outside, and they draw that track cutting call. Great work from Carolina there, forcing her out, stepping back, getting that track cutting call. Number 299, Ginger Clobbers, out of the penalty box for Carolina right now, and she is on a scoring run as well.
Yeah, the jam will run the full 2 minutes as both jammers have gone to the box. And it looks like there was a additional penalty, an illegal procedure in the penalty box, an illegal entry on Charlotte Popowski. So it looks like she has additional penalty time. We will clarify that when we get more information. Quickly through for another 5 points. That's Ginger Clobbers. Time running out on the jam. Carolina moving up to 167. Quickly out.
All right, well, we're going to go over to our friend, Reverend Killjoy, who's going to tell us a little bit about penalties. Tell us about penalties, Rev.
Well, I believe what just happened there is that Reading Rambo has fouled out of the game. She had five on the board at halftime. She just got two track cuts. And then, to add insult to injury, she was given an
illegal procedure
call. Thank you very much, Captain Lou. An illegal procedure because she knocked over a chair when she got into the penalty box. She already had seven when she knocked over the chair, but Diamond Dust, the non-skating official who got run over by that chair, did not appreciate it in the penalty box. So Reading Rambo, good job. Come back tomorrow.
Excellent.
She was wearing the star, wasn't she?
Yes, she was. Yes,
so that will be multiple minutes in the box for Suburbia. Really not want the ladies from Yonkers want to have to deal with at this point in the game. They're down by 35 points. Carolina putting a nice run on there. This is going to be an extended power jam. Sin City Skates, if we don't sell it, we wouldn't play in it. SinCityskates.com. We're going to go from a timeout to an official review, or official timeout anyways. Both coaches from
We're looking at a team timeout right now for Suburbia. So we'll take a look and see what that official timeout is about.
It looks like it advanced through Rydell, the official skate of the WFTDA. Unmatched quality, unmatched performance online at rydellskates.com. And you have to wonder how many people still are alive in the cheese balls bearing bracket bonanza.
Goodness. We have a couple hundred who are actually active in this bracket game this weekend for Kalamazoo. And a lot of these bouts were really close. Some of them were not so close. The Suburbia bout yesterday against Paper Valley was a 200-point game against them. But we're looking at Santa Cruz versus Tri-City. That's 236 to Santa Cruz, 231. That's a 5-point game. These are close games. So I know my brackets get destroyed the first day.
mine, I think, survived all right on day one this time. My Des Moines bracket just absolutely blew up. You can find out more on Cheese Balls.
I still have cinders on my hand from my Des Moines bracket.
Cheeseballs.com. That's cheese with the letter Z, or Z if you're Canadian, with the letter Z, as we are in America land.
We are, and we're also in the land of delicious donuts, apparently. Oh. I'm not going to be able to stop talking about donuts.
The morning donut is a lovely ritual.
Thank goodness I don't live here.
Also, Liftoff, provided by Derbalife, the official beverage of WFTD announcers, an all-natural energy drink for skaters and announcers alike. Visit Derbalife.com.
You know what's coming up next?
Oh, I'm so excited.
I'm going to tell you exactly what's coming up next. Division One playoffs coming up next. Fort Wayne, September 6th through the 8th. It is going to be off the hook.
Can you get a discount on that? I think you can right now. Ticketmaster code FTWAYNE. Rollback pricing $55 if you buy it this weekend. Get in there.
And we do have another timeout. I'm not sure if that was a delay of game or not, but we're still working on the timeout here. And, yeah, let's talk about these awesome discounts. Huh. There's also still a WFTDA.TV pass discount in place.
Yeah.
That's going to be until August 26th. You can get the entirety of the Division I playoffs and championships for $45.
I got in on that. I bought that. I'm going to some of these Division I's, but the value is good enough that even if you're just watching the champs and the couple, pays for itself. Jamming away, she's a freak, jamming for Carolina. And in the penalty box is Charlotte Popowski, serving for Reading Rambo.
And she is lead jammer. She's a freak. She gets forced through and down. We are still looking at a full complement, though, of Carolina and Suburbia defenders. This is 4-on-4 on the power jam still for She's a Freak, who comes up behind a two-wall that just kind of lets her go. I'm wondering if they thought that they were getting that destruction call, or at least close to it. That was a five-point pass there for She's a Freak, and we are still 4-on-4 here.
Yeah, the jammer, She's a Freak, is just absolutely killing Suburbia today. Just points after points going up on the board. Another five going up there. Under 20 minutes remaining in the game. Carolina stretching their lead with this extended power jam opportunity, Double H.
So Suburbia really choosing to do that triangular defense instead of extending their defense at the front of the pack when they're on this power jam. And it's making it a lot faster for She's a Freak to be able to get through. And with four full blockers on there, see that triangular defense that's pushing She's a Freak out? And she did not get that cut call. That was not a cut for her. Little Loca allowing her to go. There's not a whole lot of engagement. They're not really stretching those boundaries, Lou.
Yeah, they're not getting a lot of delay on Shiza's lap time. Charlotte Popowski coming out of the penalty box. So the jammer penalties woes for Suburbia are over, and Shiza being knocked to the outside, calling off the jam. But still pretty successful for Carolina. They moved to 187. Suburbia 132. Killjoy, do you have anything for us from the previous timeouts?
I do, in fact. The previous timeout was actually about assessing whether the correct number of points had been put on the board, and that has been rectified. The number of points that we see now, we believe, is accurate at the current time. And also, the things we said earlier about Reading Rambo when she was fouled out, all were true. She did have the two-minute for the two separate penalties served by Charlotte, but now all that is over and Suburbia has a fresh shot.
And that's Charlotte Popowski through to become lead jammer for Suburbia, allowing her the opportunity to score some points and get a little bit of momentum shift here with Eva Gore jamming for Carolina, stuck behind a two-all in the front. She's doing a little juke to the outside and she does get through. So Charlotte's going to get through on her scoring pass, coming up against Electrocution at the front against Carolina. And looking at her bench, that is a call-off. Charlotte looks at her bench to figure out where the opposing jammer is. She calls it. You watching at home should know that the major scoreboard, although there is a scoreboard here at turn three, the major scoreboard is actually above everybody. So if you're seeing the jammers look up to look at the period clock and the play clock, that's why they're doing it.
Yeah, this arena is amazing, though. It's got scoreboards over every one of the entrance exits throughout the seating area. So there are dozens of scoreboard opportunities to look at things. It's great. Wing Stadium in Kalamazoo, Michigan. Lauren Forcer jamming for Suburbia, and that is Ginger.
And Lauren is lead jammer. Ginger getting forced to the outside and getting a low block penalty. So this is now a power jam in favor of Suburbia, who is in the red and white. They are 136 to Carolina's 189. They've got 50 points to make up, Lou. Totally attainable here, but they've really got to push those boundaries. That is a four-point pass 4, Suburbia.
Shifting it to 5, realizing that it is a power jam now. Jammer ref Dizzy Duzzer following Lauren around. Lauren looking through to get for another 5 points. Yes, Suburbia with an opportunity to shift the momentum once again in this game. Lots of time for them to claw their way back. This is the best opportunity that they'll see. Another 5 there, Double H. 15 points for Lauren Forster so far.
And that was great work defensively, getting a little Loca busted up that 3-wall, but it also cost her a penalty. And that is another 5-point pass for Suburbia. So now we are 3-on-3 in the pack. And we do have another Carolina defender. That is number 66, Daisy Rage, going to the penalty box. So we are 3-on-3. 3-wall at the front from Carolina. They let her go. They do not want to draw those destruction penalties. And I think they're really playing it safe. I see a lot of these walls playing it very safe. They'll try the triangular defense, but they are afraid of drawing those destruction penalties.
Yeah, and sometimes those, if you get all those penalties, you end up drawing out the pain of the power jam so much longer, because even when your jammer gets back on there, if you only have 2 blockers, it's that much more difficult. 25 points put up on the board. Malcolm Sachs getting his jammer to call it off. Icing. Ginger in the box, and Charlotte Scary have a chance to have a power start.
And she is coming up against a 3-wall at the front, and she does get lead jammer status. As I mentioned, that is 5-5-5, getting an out-of-play penalty. And this is an issue for both of these teams. They definitely want to keep these packs together without incurring those out-of-play penalties. Beautiful little apex skip for Charlotte Pupowski. That's a 4-point pass for her.
Right at the end of the jam, Ginger Clobbers picking up a back block major. She's going to the box. Another power jam opportunity for Suburbia as they continue to close this gap with Carolina. 14 minutes and 20 seconds remaining in the game. Illegal procedure indicated by rule enforcer from the outside. So.
And that is Lauren Forster, number 50, jamming for Suburbia. We are 3-on-2 pack advantage for Carolina, but they're forced to let her go. We're seeing a beautiful 3-wall at the front, and now I'm not sure if she was in the queue or not, but that is another Suburbia defender headed to the penalty box. Meanwhile, little Loca coming out of the penalty box, and that is a back block call against Lauren Forster. This is not what Suburbia wanted to see. This was a perfect opportunity for them to make up that 25-point difference. Suburbia 165, Carolina 190.
Yeah, bench coach Malcolm Sachs indicating that it's okay, just grab a seat in the box. We're closed half the gap in this one. Now they just have to kill a bit of time. She'll only have to serve as much time as Ginger Clobber served, which was not long. She got to the box fairly quickly, and she's out. We're going to go the full 2 minutes. Both jammers on the track. Both teams able to score points now, Double H.
And we do have 4-on-3. This is pack advantage for Carolina. That is a 5-point pass, though. Lauren Forster, who is finishing her pass from before she went into the penalty box, picked up all 5. That is Ginger through for a 4-point pass. And we are full up here with Carolina blockers. We do just have 3, and now we are completely a full deck of cards. Both jammers scoring, all 4 blockers now on the track. Lauren Forster really getting a nice knock there from Eva Gore, coming back strong on the inside to get past electrocution, and that is a 4-point pass for Suburbia.
Yeah, Ginger Clobber is getting stuck on the back. All the bodies hit the ground on turn 2, including Ginger. Everybody gets up. Looks like no one's going to pick up a penalty on that, but coming around on the track, ready to pick up points, that's Lauren Forster.
Ginger finding a nice weave through the pack, makes it through for another 4 points for her. Each one of these jammers working. There's about 4 seconds left of this jam. A little bit of time. That was a little bit of time for Lauren to pick up a few more points, but she looked pretty tired in the middle of the pack coming up behind those Carolina defenders, so she kind of slowed down a little bit.
2 points. We're going to get a timeout or an official review. It's an official review for Suburbia. Suburbia at 176, Carolina at 203. Suburbia was down by 25 points at the beginning of the last jam, now down by 27 points. So pretty much a wash. Gave up 2 points on that. Not too bad. Check out the photos from the WFTDA photo booth sponsored by Viva Las Vegas Skates at facebook.com/WFTDA and more about Viva Las Vegas Skates online at vivalaskates.com. Those photo booths are fun. We're going to see lots of great photos from the tournaments.
And we want to hear from you as well. You're out there on Twitter, on Facebook and social media, hashtag talk2WFTDA. That's talk2WFTDA. And we've been looking forward to a lot of the photos that you guys have been sending us. Because we asked you to show us some examples of how you watch, and keep it clean, of course, how you watch Division II playoffs. I'm telling you, Captain Lou, there have been so many photos of animals watching roller derby. I feel like our primary audience is probably of the animal kingdom. But still, keep the photos coming. If you have babies who enjoy watching roller derby, we like babies too. And maybe our producer, Speed Bump, will actually include them on WFTDA.tv, and your baby could be famous. Your dog could be famous.
Famous derby babies and derby dogs, derby cats from around the world. We want to see these pictures. Also, Adam Wheels, a proud partner and official wheel of the WFTDA, online at adamwheels.com. And speaking of WFTDA, did you know that we're still looking for sponsors for WFTDA.tv. We've got Division I tournaments coming up. You can talk directly to thousands of derby fans, advertise on WFTDA.tv. Affordable packages are available for your business, boot camp, or tournament advertising. Visit WFTDA.com/sponsors/opportunities to learn more. There's going to be so many people tuning in to these Division I playoff tournaments. Who's playing at the Division I in Fort Wayne, Double H? There's amazing teams that are going to be there.
It is just so exciting to read that I don't even know if I can do it. It's Denver, Montreal, arch rival, London, Rose City, Ohio, Wasatch, Cincinnati, Bleeding Heartland, and Grand Raggedy. I mean, Fort Wayne doesn't know what's coming. They really have no idea what is about to descend on them. September 6th through the 8th.
Yeah, when I saw the lineup, I was like, yeah, Fort Wayne, I'm going no matter what. That is a game, a tournament that's going to be, I mean, the first round matchups, there are teams that probably could make it to the championships that will be eliminated in the first round because they have to play against each other. You're going to see arch rival in Ohio facing off again. They had an epic battle last year in the old North Central Regionals. They've played this year already with arch rival winning. This is the rubber match, London versus Rose City.
I think that's also the beauty of the new ranking system and the new division system is that you're going to see teams who haven't really necessarily had a chance to play one another or test their skill against one another. But really now is go time. You come to these Division I, Division II playoffs, and there are no more on papers. You get to see exactly what their skill is on the track against one another. And what's kind of crazy and creative about the entire season is that we've really seen that throughout the entire length of the WFTDA season, especially on WFTDA.tv. If you go back to the East Coast Derby extravaganza, we see matchups that on paper look a certain way and then turn out to be absolutely and totally different. I would say that the Texas-Philly matchup was one of those matchups that you thought would be a little more evenly weighted. And then certainly Philly got to play Windy and the score was much different. And then later the next month, during the Golden Bowl, Windy came out like gangbusters. So really, the new ranking system has the opportunity for so many surprises, Captain Lou.
Yeah, it's nonstop excitement. This is my favorite time of year, playoffs after playoffs.
Yes.
I get nothing done.
It's a non-denominational roller derby holiday.
Yep. We're getting some information from Null Pointer Ref, the head referee. Head referee's given microphones this year to discuss things with the crowd. We'll get Killjoy. Do you have some information for us on that?
I do. Suburbia challenged wanting a low block call on the Carolina Jammer, and that call was agreed with. So the penalty was called. Carolina is in the box, and this is a power jam for Charlotte Popowski of Suburbia.
Wow. We have seen that this weekend. There have been a fair number of challenges that have been upheld. Really nice use of the official review. And it's some great coaching being brought into roller derby as well. Not only great skating, but great coaching, making the team just that much better.
I think that's what's exciting is the fact that not only can you challenge things, but, you know, you can overturn things too. And I think being really smart in your coaching and perceptive in the environment in which your skaters are skating is really key to that. And we've seen, like you said, we've seen a lot of that not only this weekend, but throughout the tournament so far, Division II in Des Moines as well. We saw a bit of that, which is kind of fantastic. Also fantastic, Charlotte Bupowski jamming solo, as you mentioned, Captain Lou.
And Charlotte getting through quickly for lead jammer. Suburbia down by 26 points. An additional point was put up on the board for Suburbia at the break as well. So they need to close the gap a little bit more, but a great opportunity with still 11 and a half minutes remaining in the game.
And we do see her skip through for a 5-point pass. We're looking at a four wall against a four wall here in the pack. We're pretty equal. That four wall splits into a two wall at the back from Suburbia, and they are hanging back. Meanwhile, 187. That's Caddy Compton. She's bridging, working on the bridge. They're extending in the front, but they're allowing her to go to not get those destruction or out of play calls there. That's a 5-point pass for Suburbia. Another beautiful wall here of four. This looks a bit more like a diamond than a triangle. And taking a look at the box to see Carolina's jammer standing, that is a call off from Suburbia.
Yeah, and you've seen that a lot this year. It's more of a time management thing for teams. A lot of time before when you had the power jam, you would just run and get all the points as long as you could. And now it's just like, well, we're not gonna go for those extra points. We're gonna called off. We're gonna go for the extra lead jammer. We'll be able to control the time as opposed to necessarily maximize the points. And in the end, it works out overall. So.
And that is Lauren Forcer making her way to the front of the pack. Coming up behind, that is number 12, MC Fight for Carolina, but she's forced to let her go. And we now have a lead jammer status for Lauren. And we also have 299. That's Ginger Clobbers back from the penalty box. So she makes it through for her initial pass. And we're still looking at Lauren trying to mix it up in the back of the pack, now getting forced to the front. And that is an out-of-play call going to a Suburbia defender. That is going to be number 88, Helda Reyes. That's a 5-point pass for Suburbia. They're getting there.
Yeah, it's 192 for Suburbia. The ladies from Yonkers, New York, pulling closer to the ladies from Raleigh, North Carolina. An 11-point game. North Carolina, there's a Division I tournament happening in North Carolina, isn't there?
It's going to be fun, too, in Asheville. That is going to be good times. Another awesome Division I tournament headed the way of folks. Charlotte Bupowski stuck at the back of the pack for Suburbia. That is She's a Freak up at the front. Caddy Compton coming out the inside to push Suburbia's jammer out of bounds. She still is lead jammer, though. That is Charlotte Bupowski, lead jammer in front of her. She's a Freak, who had a nice hole open to her for her by Caddy. Beautiful work there at the front of the pack.
So Caddy paying the price, going to the box for a forearm for that hit. Charlotte still picking up lead jammer, but again, doing double duty there, opening up a gap for her jammer to get out and trying to contain the jammer. She'll have to sit for a minute in the Notorious R.E.D. penalty box. Smell clean, even if you play dirty. Check out NotoriousRED.com.
I think no one really likes to admit it most of the time, but if you're low on penalties, sometimes those risks pay off for you.
Absolutely.
To get those larger penalties. That is Lauren Forcer jamming against She's a Freak. She's a Freak coming up the front of the pack behind a two wall of Suburban defenders. Meanwhile, almost sprinting through the pack, that is Lauren Forcer for Suburbia. She is lead jammer. She's a Freak has broken through the pack. This is an opportunity for Lauren to grab a couple of points, I imagine, before she calls it. But Carolina taking off, slowing down a bit now, though, allowing a huge point scoring opportunity. Carolina really didn't do much for their jammer there. They should have sped up a little bit. Instead, they were point scoring opportunities. That was four for Suburbia.
Yeah, quickly threw on the outside. Little rotation around the blockers. All the points going up on the board for Suburbia. 196 to Carolina's 203. A 7-point game with 7 minutes and 45 seconds remaining. Again, another barn burner at the Kalamazoo D2.
And we are looking at 3-on-3 in this pack. That is number 26, Katie Klismic, jamming for Carolina. That is Charlotte Bukowski jamming for Suburbia. Katie coming up behind, in front of a three wall. Beautiful work there again from Suburbia, allowing their jammer through on the outside. That's Charlotte Bukowski lead jammer. And that is going to be a low block call assessed to Little Loca, number 66, going to the box for Suburbia.
That was an unfortunate accident for Little Loca. She went down, accidentally tripped the jammer for Carolina, picked up that low block, but she got sucked back into the pack, allowing the Suburbia jammer, Charlotte, to go through and pick up points. Calls off the jam, does like 4 360s, and picks up 4 points. That puts him at 200. It's a 3-point game, Double H.
If she were to get judged on those 360s as skateboarders do, I would give her a very high score because that was excellent footwork. She remained on her skates throughout the entire time and used it to her advantage. She used that power, that force, to spin her around the last remaining defenders, and that was a great point-scoring run there for Suburbia. Now we're within 3 points, Lou.
Timeout for Carolina. High points for flair from Charlotte Popowski on that last jam. Sin City Skates, the first, the best. Happy to fix the rest. SinCityskates.com. Timeout for Carolina, probably not a bad idea. I know you kind of want to save your timeouts just for the last little bit, just in case, but they've got the lead still. If they can reset their team, fight it out for the last 6 minutes and 43 seconds, get things back under control, and they're going to try to do that by putting Caddy Compton on the line. She's a high-risk blocker, high-risk jammer. We'll see if this pays off for Carolina.
And they will still have another timeout, and it looks like their official review left as well. So I think a timeout here is a perfect opportunity for them to try to get their strategy back together. Again, 1-87 Caddy Compton against 50 Lauren Forcer for Suburbia. Suburbia again in the red and white. That is Carolina in the black and red and white. And oh, Caddy is not okay with that penalty. She is getting, it looks like a black back block. It is a back block penalty that she's being assessed. And I heard her scream out in disdain because this allows Lauren the opportunity for a power jam. And there are only two defenders there for Carolina. And one of them right now is going to get an out of play call, I believe, sending her to the penalty box. So now there is 3-on-1.
And those 5 points picked up by Lauren Forcer has allowed Suburbia to regain the lead. Another 5 points going up on the board. Suburbia now in the lead, 210 to 203. The power jam continues, Double H.
And we're seeing 2-on-3 from Carolina, but still 5 more points for Suburbia. This is the opportunity that they were looking for, and they are going for it here.
MC Fight heading to the notorious RED penalty box. Another 5 points going on the board for Suburbia. Electrocution coming out of the penalty box, looking to provide blocker assistance for Carolina. Here comes Lauren Forcer for another scoring pass, Double H.
On the inside, she just slips through easily. Carolina looking to wall it up in the back, and that is the end of the jam. Suburbia visibly excited. They put a handful of points on the board. That's going to put them up. We're now 225 Suburbia against 203 Carolina, who has not scored in the last several jams with 5 minutes left on the clock.
So 25-point power jam for Lauren Forcer. Caddy Compton is standing in the penalty box. Malcolm Sex was looking for an additional minute, I believe. Killjoy, do you have anything on that? Or? Nope. Okay, we're going to look for some clarification. But, Malcolm Sex hopping up and down. He got his jammer to call off the jam before Caddy could come out. So he will at least get a power start here. But I think he is looking for an additional minute.
We will take a look
Carolina
and see.
Carolina taking their last timeout.
Yes. And actually, I agree with that. I think this is the perfect opportunity for them to just take a breath, take a second, reset their strategy. because they're not going to be able to put up those massive points unless they are able to contain Suburbia's offense, but then also they need to stay penalty free. And I know it's the most ridiculously redundant thing to say over and over again, but
but it's true.
It's true.
It's roller derby. It's totally true in roller derby. It really is.
And the other thing working against Carolina here is that they are two blockers to Suburbia's four. Their jammer really has an advantage here because of that. That's Charlotte Pupowski. And we are looking at that two-all pushing her out of bounds at turn one. That is 66 Daisy Rage, and she is getting that call, that multiplayer call.
Caddy out of the box, picking up lead jammer. Like, her pants are on fire. She is skating hard, looking to bring Carolina back into this game, Double H.
While everyone was busy looking at that multiplayer call, Caddy slips out through the pack. And she is lead jammer, calls it very wisely, keeping Suburbia from scoring any points. That's only a three-point game, but that's okay. This is the momentum that Carolina needs to sort of turn things around. Just a couple of points at a time is okay for them here, as long as they can get back into it for the last 4 minutes.
That's right. If they can keep getting lead jammer, keep putting those points up on the board, they've got 4 minutes. They can still get five jams in if they push it hard. They've got their official review yet that they can use to stop the clock one more time. They're going to get She's a Freak out there, the big point scorer for Carolina. And it's a light, light pack out there right now, Double H.
It's coming up against AWOL from Suburbia. Beautiful two-all in front from Suburbia. Not able to contain She's a Freak, though. She's through to become lead jammer. This is going to become a faster game, I think, here, Lou. Both of these jammers out of the pack looking for points. We do have 3-on-2 for Carolina. They need to contain their opponents here to score some points because they're sitting in the back. They are points that are just waiting to happen, and She's a Freak knows it. She is not happy about that. The back of her pack, that three wall, was open season for AWOL.
Yeah, and there were points just waiting for her up at the front, but she could not get to them. 30 seconds erased from the clock as She's a tries to get the points. Carolina has to reset, do it again. 3 minutes remaining in the game, 225 for the Suburban Brawl from Suburbia. Carolina Roller Girls, 206, 19 point deficit, under 3 minutes remaining.
That is Katie Klismick jamming for Carolina against, and that is Lauren Forcer again, lead jammer for Suburbia in the red and white. But Katie has broken through the pack. Now, here's what Carolina's doing differently. They're racing to the front of the pack because now their opposing jammer is a lot closer to them. And we are seeing this faster speed again. They're trying to get out of the way. They do not want to become points. Lauren sees Katie right on her heels. She's sizing up the number of points right now at the back of the pack. Both of these jammers just racing to try to grab some points. Lauren trying to hold Katie behind her, looking for an inside line, finds one downed blocker, picks up a point, really looking to size up Ginger to see if she can grab her point as well. Snakes around her and comes around the outside. We're still looking to see if Katie's got 1 point. She might have one at the back of the pack. Lauren really doing a good job of wearing this jam out. Beautiful clock management from Suburbia here.
Yeah, I saw early on in the jam, Malcolm Sachs, a bench coach, indicated 2 to her, saying that he wants her to skate for the full 2 minutes, kill the time off the clock. Even if they give up points in this jam, they probably won't give up the full 19. Lauren doing a good job of keeping the pack fast, making Carolina skate up. A forearm to electrocution.
Yes, that was absolutely a forearm to Electra. And I think she might be in the queue, possibly.
Yep.
Or that was a waved off call. Yeah, no, she has to go all the way around. That is the problem. She needs to go all the way around to enter the box. Great work here from Lauren, really holding on and wearing out her opposing jammer, burning down that clock. That's a 4-point game. That's just insurance that Suburbia is hoping for. Meanwhile, Katie has also scored 4 points of her own. That's Katie Klismick.
Wow.
And the jam comes to a conclusion. I am really impressed with Suburbia's clock management there.
Absolutely. That was impressive. It was, you know, you trade points for time at this point in the game. Absolutely fantastic. Carolina really down to possibly only having the opportunity to get one more jam in. They'll only have about 30 seconds remaining in the game when this jam takes off. Electrocution looking like she has fouled out from the game. So Carolina will not have her in the final jam. She's a freak going the line for Carolina. That's the jammer I would want to have if I wanted a chance to close these 19 points.
And that is Charlotte Bubowski for Suburbia that gets forced to the ground and back up. She's coming out, gets forced outside at turn one, forced to go all the way around, but draws a cutting penalty. This is a power jam for Carolina. Beautiful work from Carolina's defense drawing that cut at the back of the pack. We are now 4-on-3. There is a strong four wall that just opens up for She's a Freak, and that is a 5-point pass. We are looking at a minute and 25 left on that jam clock. This is plenty of time for her, Lou.
Hard hit to the inside, but she spins around on one skate, saying she got hit in the face, but putting 5 points on the board. Carolina has climbed to within 9 points of Suburbia. Over a minute remaining in the jam. No time left on the period clock.
And this is a three-wall, a two-wall, forcing her to the inside, but not out of bounds. She stumbles through. 5-point pass on that. She's still got 57 minutes left on the clock. She only needs 5 more points to win this game. She is coming through, and we do not even have the opposing jammer standing in the box yet. So she's got time to work on this, and all she really has to do is make it through, and that is going to be the winning point there. All she has to do is play it safe. She could even call it if she wants, but if she
there
wants
it is.
To have some insurance, we do have 230 Carolina, 229 Suburbia. And
yes.
That is the game. And it looks like Little Loca is trying to call for a timeout, but she doesn't know that there isn't any time left
in the period. Yeah, Shiza was actually looking up at the scoreboard. The scoreboard had only given her 4 points initially. She looked up and realized that she might have to keep going. The scoreboard then switched to 230 to 229 while she couldn't see the scoreboard. And all her teammates are flapping their arms, tapping their hips. She spun around quickly, put her hands on the hips, and it looks like Carolina may have snuck this game out in the last jam.
It's a really tough call too, Lou, because
wow.
You're talking about a situation where if you're a jammer and you cannot see the scoreboard correctly, you're going to want to get as many points as you possibly can because you don't know if you've actually won the game or not. We've actually seen that over the last couple Division II games, even in Des Moines, where we had a bit of a heartbreaker at the end of, I believe it was DC taking on Omaha, where there was a 3-point game and both one of those teams really trying hard to score as many points as possible. And we've seen so many last minute jams that you really don't want to take anything for granted, but we are getting the final. It is a 1-point victory for Carolina Roller
wow.
Girls against Suburbia, Lou. This is awesome.
There's going to be some pretty happy people in North Carolina watching this bout. Absolutely fantastic on both parties. Momentum shifts back and forth. Suburbia doing everything they could to kill the time in that game, and then Carolina picking up that power jam opportunity on the last jam of the game and pulling it out in the end.
Suburbia needs to be really proud of their performance here. They did such great work offensively. Their clock management was really fantastic at the end of this game. I think, as always, penalties a huge factor, specifically for the jammers here. We're seeing such great skating out of both of these teams here today in this game, and you couldn't have asked for a closer bout, a 1-point game.
Nice way to start off day number two of the Division II in Kalamazoo. Carolina's going to play again today. They're going to play at 4 o'clock against Tri-City, and that will be for an opportunity to go on to the 5th place game. Suburbia now relegated down to playing for 9th and 10th place, but you know, they came in 10th place. They managed to sneak in with a couple teams not accepting their bid, so they were additions at the end. Awesome opportunity for them to be here. This is a great result for them. I mean, this is going to be worth good ranking points for them. I know every team wants to have the win, but when they walk away from it, this is going to help them in the long run.
And any experience that you have at a tournament level is going to help you.
Yeah, I mean, these are fantastic events. They really are. I really love coming to the WFTDA playoffs. You get to see so many teams come together. You get to see all sorts of different styles, different strategies. You see teams learning as they play during the weekend, learning new strategies, picking up things from other teams. I think you saw that last weekend with Treasure Valley, just playing fantastic all weekend long. Suburbia taking Carolina right to the last jam. I mean, that's the 10 versus 4. fantastic result for them, I really.
And you're not going to want to miss a hit. WFTVA.TV has had some of the best derby I've seen in a very long time over the last two weekends of Division II. And it's only going to get better because there's even more derby throughout the entire month of September for the Division I tournaments.
Yeah, I'm going to say flat out, if you are not enjoying this WFTVA roller derby action this weekend, you're crazy, because these are great games.
If you're liking,
yeah, check your pulse, because you're not a roller derby fan if you're not liking this roller derby action. My heart has stopped multiple times this weekend. This is great.
Well, we're going to go get the defib for Captain Lou. I'm Double H. We're going to thank some of our sponsors. And coming back after this, we're going to come back with Burning River taking on Queen City for the number 8 game. Saturday, 12 o'clock, Kalamazoo, Michigan. Come right back here after we thank some of our sponsors. Don't miss a hit.
They told us to just sell skates online. You won't have any overhead. Put some skulls in your advertising. You'll make a mint. That was never our plan. Our plan was to make a store where all day we are fitting skaters, fixing skates, teaching customers, and putting the best gear on their bodies. Before we put 3 W's in front of our name, we made sure we had hundreds of happy customers come through our doors. We're not just derby owned, we're derby dedicated. Fast Girl Skates.
Pond 5.